Tiến Minh xin kính chào quý vị khán giả đang theo dõi chuyên mục Sài Gòn và tôi. Quý vị và các bạn thân mến, trên tay Tuyết Minh là cuốn sách tựa đề Philip Noyce từ đường làng tới đại lộ Hollywood. Và cũng qua đoạn ghi hình vừa rồi, có lẽ quý vị và các bạn đã biết được nhân vật khách mời của Sài Gòn và tôi kỳ này là ai rồi phải không ạ? Xin trân trọng giới thiệu vị đạo diễn tài ba đến từ kinh đô điện ảnh Hoa Kỳ, đạo diễn Philip Noyce. Hello, Mr. Philip Noyce. Welcome back to Vietnam and thanks for coming to this talk show.
It's my pleasure. Hello to you and hello everyone out there watching the show.
Since 1975, you have been in Vietnam for several times. As I know, last year you have just come back to Vietnam to participate in the first Vietnam International Film Festival. How about this time? What would you say about your return?
Well, this time I'm here to promote this book, which Saigon Media has brought out. It's a book called Backroads to Hollywood, being released in a Vietnamese version, which is the story of my story of making movies, starting as a young man in Australia in a small town, and making bigger and bigger and bigger movies, and finally ending up making huge movies right in the heart of movie making in Hollywood.
And talk about the city. Is there anything that really not used from the first time until now?
Ho Chi Minh City, when I first came here, it was a city of bicycles and ciclos and motorbikes. So just the first change you see is the change in how people get around. Now you don't see so many bicycles, not so many ciclos, a lot more motorbikes, and now cars. And of course, the cars even have changed, because in the old days, a lot of old American cars and old French cars, little Japanese cars. Now on the streets of Saigon, you know, you see big luxury cars. You know, so in the way people get around, the city has changed. But the city's also changed in many other ways. Take, for example, the square outside the Hotel Continental and the Opera House, where we shot a lot of my film, The Quiet American. That square is almost completely changed from the first time I came here.
What do you think about, like, how the city is changing itself? I mean, the value part of the past may not be foul anymore?
Well, this is a country and a city that has undergone enormous change. So sometimes when a country and a city goes through a revolution, as has happened in Vietnam, sometimes you have to take a wider view of history, not 10 years, not 20 years, not 50 years, but maybe you have to look at things over a couple of centuries even. So, you know, there's a new Vietnam now. You know, Vietnam is remaking itself. In some ways, you could say that is the Saigon that's being remade by Vietnamese now. That's one way of looking at it. And that Saigon maybe is going to be more like Shanghai than the old Saigon. Maybe it's going to be, you know, a lot of skyscrapers. And maybe that's the Vietnam, that's the Saigon that Saigonese want, maybe. That's one theory. The other, of course, is that, you know, the past, the present, and the future have to live together and coexist, and that the French heritage of Saigon is a very important part of the history of the city. And I can sympathize with that because, you know, there's so many beautiful old buildings. They were small rooms, they didn't have air conditioning, and they weren't very well maintained, but that was a part of Saigon's history. I guess the real solution, maybe past and the present could live together. For example, you know, if old buildings could be retained and new buildings could go up around them, keeping the facade of the old and then building around, that would be perfect.
Miễn là có thể kiếm tiền tự làm những bộ phim ngắn đầu tay, cho đến những phim điện ảnh đầu tiên, và rồi những bộ phim làm nên tên tuổi. Đạo diễn Philip Noyce luôn bận rộn với chiếc điện thoại trên tay. Ông ghi lại mọi hình ảnh, bắt lại mọi khoảnh khắc, mà theo ông không chỉ là tư liệu làm phim, nhưng còn là những cảm hứng và ý tưởng cho ông khi thực hiện những bộ phim của mình. Nó giúp ông thực hiện những tác phẩm khiến người ta không thể phân loại được ông, giống như con tắc kè qua, nhưng luôn tràn ngập tính nhân văn trong cuộc sống đời thường.
Most Vietnamese filmmakers and filmgoers have been seen a lot of your big movies, such as The Quiet American and The Rabbit Truth Fence and Sound. So there are many movies and documentaries you have made, but which one is your most memorable?
The one that really touched me was not any of the films that I made in Hollywood. It was Rabbit Proof Fence. Rabbit Proof Fence was a film that I made back in Australia for a very small budget. It's the cheapest movie that I've ever made, practically. But it had a huge impact in Australia. It was the story of three black Australians, Aboriginals, children who were taken from their families to be re-educated, to have the black taken out of them and to be made into Europeans. In an institution, and they escaped. That's a real story. They escaped, and they walked 1,500 miles, 2,000 kilometers across the Australian desert to get back to their homeland. And so this was a real story, and it was very successful as a film in Australia and all around the world, and it helped. To make us white Australians to think about their relationship with black Australians. And it led to an official apology from the Australian government to the Aboriginal people for the treatment that they received. So it was a film that was a commercial success, but it also changed minds and hearts of people. After 10 years in Hollywood, I sort of felt like, in a way, that I had become a part of a conveyor belt. A factory. I felt that I was making other people's stories, not my stories. And I wanted to do not their films, but my films. And so I moved back to Australia. There I made two films, Rabbit Proof Fence. Immediately after Rabbit Proof Fence, I made The Quiet American here in Vietnam. And it was funny because, I turned my back on Hollywood. And it was a big risk. In a way, because I didn't know whether I'd find an audience for Rabbit Proof Fence and The Quiet American. I didn't even know if I'd find the money for those two films. But, I bet on myself, and the bet paid off because the two films were sold all around the world and they came out one after the other. I shot them back to back, Rabbit Proof Fence at first, and then straight away we started Quiet American. Finally, both films came out at the same time. And for me, it was a tremendously rewarding experience because somehow, the critics liked both films. And they were critically the most successful films that I ever made. I sometimes think that if I hadn't have done that, if I hadn't have left that factory, then my career would have been destroyed in a way. So by leaving and going back to Australia and making the films that were close to my heart, in a way I was born again, but I was reborn, as a filmmaker as an artist.
Yeah, and you have made a very big risk for your career.
When he heard the explosions, and then he came and joined the crowd. So he says we've got the placement of the bombs correct. The bombs are in the right place.
The square in the Quiet American was not the same then as it is today. There were changes in the architecture, but one big change.
Quảng trường này trong phim Người Mỹ Trầm Lặng không giống như hiện nay. Kiến trúc xây dựng đã thay đổi. Nhưng có một điều thay đổi lớn trong phim mà chúng tôi thực hiện, đó là khách sạn Continental thực tế là ở đó. Nhưng chúng tôi đã chuyển vị trí sang phía này.
The Caravelle Hotel over there, and we built in CG computer.
Chúng tôi đã thực hiện nó bằng quá trình xử lý kỹ thuật hậu kỳ. Vị trí đó, nơi phường uống cà phê buổi sáng đã không còn. Có lẽ nơi này sắp xuất hiện một tòa nhà mới. Nó đã thay đổi hoàn toàn.
Fung's Cafe was.
Well,
Fung's Cafe, of course, is no longer. It's now going to be a new development.
Chúng tôi dựng vụ nổ bom tại quảng trường. Nơi này là quán cà phê của khách sạn. Mọi người đi lại nói chuyện. Lúc đó chúng tôi dừng xe xích lô, dài chiếc xe hơi qua lại nơi này. Tất nhiên là không có xe máy. Một quả bom phát nổ góc đó, và sau đó là một quả khác trước nhà hát thành phố. Chúng tôi đã ngăn chặn các đoạn đường ở đây và bàn điều khiển nằm ở vị trí đó.